Hi, I'm Patrick Scott. Welcome back to PLS 101, American Democracy and Citizenship. In this session, we're going to continue our discussion on public policymaking, and specifically, we're going to be delving into some different arenas of policy, and we'll be talking specifically about economic policy as well as social welfare policy. And then in our next session, we'll be talking about foreign and defense policy. So we'll start here talking first of all about economic policy. If we go back to the very beginning of our founding of our country, you may remember Alexander Hamilton, the person on your $10 bill. He was one of the first to advocate an active role of government in economic policy. Our national involvement in economic affairs first began with Alexander Hamilton. As you may remember, he was the one who proposed the creation of a national bank. And as you might expect, there was a disagreement between his philosophy and that of Thomas Jefferson, who believed that economic policy really should be left up to the state and local governments. But again, this whole idea about government involvement in the economy fitting quite well with their respective philosophies about the role of government. Hamilton, as you know, wanted a strong central government. Jefferson feared a strong executive, and the central government should be small and give more power and control at the local level. We haven't really pointed this out before, but what's interesting is that even though that was Jefferson's model and philosophy about government, when he became president, he found himself in a lot of ways acting more and more like a Federalist in terms of some of his decisions. But in terms of economic policy, if we're discussing and studying that today, there are basically two categories of economic policy. There's monetary policy and fiscal policy. Monetary policy involves control over the money supply, and that is how much money is circulating in our economy at any one time. And fiscal policy involves decisions by government in terms of spending and taxing, how much government, for example, is spending to influence our economy. At the outset, what I'd like to suggest to you is that these two mechanisms, monetary policy and fiscal policy, think of them as two sluggish levers on a huge jet, like a 747 or 787 Boeing. And the idea behind this is that as the plane is taking off, you've got these two levers to help guide you as part of the controls. They're very sluggish in nature, and what happens is that in your ideal state is that you want that jet steadily moving in an upward direction, not too fast, not to accelerate too much or too high, and not to slow down or decelerate. And so the idea is that you're going to use these two sluggish levers to essentially try to steer that jet in that ideal direction. And that is what we try to achieve with monetary and fiscal policy. Now with monetary policy, let's talk a little bit about one of these levers here. Monetary policy, again, involves control over the money supply. And the question is, why do we have government control the money supply? Well, the amount of money circulating in the economy at any one time affects all sorts of things like interest rates. When we have a tight supply, when there's not, relatively speaking, not as much money circulating in the economy, interest rates tend to be high, but inflation tends to be low. When we have a lot of money circulating in the economy at any one time, interest rates tend to go down, but on the other hand, inflation tends to kick in. And so that's a bit of a problem that we have to try to find the right balance between the two. Now, who controls this money supply? This is controlled by an entity known as the Federal Reserve, or the Federal Reserve System. The Federal Reserve System is actually comprised of 12 regional banks, and your text shows, for example, the different banks across the country and the different regions associated with each of these banks, but 12 regional banks and also a Federal Reserve Board. And that Federal Reserve Board is located in Washington, D.C., and it's comprised of a board of seven governors from these regional banks. The Federal Reserve Board and the banks regulate how much money is circulating in the system. So, for example, if the economy is sluggish or when unemployment is high, the Federal Reserve will try to stimulate growth by increasing the supply of money. This will lead to a decrease in interest rates so that people will then start spending money. They'll start borrowing more, for new houses, new cars, new capital investment in businesses to create new jobs. So the idea here then is when the economy is sluggish, you're going to increase the supply of money. When the supply of money increases, the interest rates will decrease, it'll be easier to borrow money, and when it becomes easier to borrow money and to pay money, people are going to buy houses where they might have not been able to afford a house at one point in time because the interest rates were too high and therefore the payments would be too high. Now they can find that the payments are within the realm of affordability. And so that will naturally encourage people to start buying and investing in, again, capital for new businesses, and that in turn will create new jobs. On the other hand, if the economy is heating up too quickly, then they'll do the opposite. That is, they will lead that can lead to inflation. So the Fed will try to decrease the money supply. This will cause interest rates to rise and hopefully cut back on borrowing money for and therefore spending on new items. The chair, by the way, of the Federal Reserve Board is a person by the name of Ben Bernanke. And before him, he took the place of Alan Greenspan. The Federal Reserve Board and the Federal Reserve banks also do this. They also lend money to private banks. Now, so besides controlling the money supply, they're also lending money to banks. The Board of Governors, when they're lending money to banks, will set what's called the lending rate. It's also called the discount rate or the prime rate. And this is the level at which the Federal Reserve banks will loan money. If they increase the discount rate, the prime rate, that they increase that lending rate, if that rate goes up, then naturally what banks charge to consumers through credit cards and other kinds of things, then that rate will also go up. So when your interest rate on your credit card will go up when that happens, if it's a variable rate. If the rate goes down, that prime rate goes down, then interest rates also goes down. Interest rates will also go down, and it'll become easier to borrow money. In that regard, if you want to take a loan for automobile or something like that, if the prime rate goes down, then that auto loan becomes cheaper and easier to pay off. So, the Federal Reserve Board, known as the Fed, can increase or decrease the money supply, and they can also set the prime lending rate on what they will lend. The Federal Reserve banks will lend to private banks. And again, both of these can affect the economy in, again, very, very big ways in terms of construction on new houses, in terms of cars, in terms of student loans, in terms of having money available to expand your businesses, things like that. So that's the idea. That's one of these sluggish levers known as that we're talking about in terms of trying to keep the economy on an even keel, and that is through controlling the monetary supply or monetary policy. Now, fiscal policy is a little bit different. This is simply the idea of how much the government decides to spend and how much it decides to tax. If the economy is sluggish, then the government can actually, because the government plays such a major role in terms of our economy, in terms of our gross domestic product, our GDP, it can have a major role in terms of its decisions, in terms of influencing the economy. So if the economy is sluggish, government can stimulate the economy by increasing the level of spending. And so, for example, a lot of people go back to a very famous British economist named John Maynard Keynes, who was an advisor to Roosevelt during the Depression. And he was one of the first to advocate using fiscal policy to stimulate the economy. And because we spent so much during World War II, a lot of people suggest that World War II and the government spending that was required because of that is what really got us out of the Depression. But besides spending money to increase and stimulate the economy, government can do the opposite as well. It can cut back on its spending. Also, besides the spending decisions, can be tax decisions. If you increase taxes, the money that could be going to private enterprise enhancing your business or whatever, if government increases corporate taxes, then that can have a decelerating effect on the economy. It can slow down the economy. If you have a sluggish economy, increasing taxes would be a bad thing to do. Instead, what you would want to do is to cut taxes. By cutting taxes, that would stimulate the economy. All right. So basically, that would help to put more money in your pocket and allow that would have an indirect effect on stimulating the economy. So the point here is that fiscal policy involves spending issues, spending decisions to increase or decrease, but the mirrored opposite of that is in terms of tax decisions, to increase taxes or to decrease taxes. And again, if government can, think about this, if government cuts taxes, that may stimulate the economy, but if it also spends money at the same time, it doesn't curtail spending, so it's spending money and cutting back taxes, that can have a double amplitude effect on stimulating the economy. But on the other hand, the downside of that is it can potentially increase the deficit or lead to deficit spending. Now, as part of fiscal policy, one of the things that John Maynard Keynes emphasized was this notion of counter-cyclical fiscal policy. In other words, the idea behind this is that we're going to make these tie these spending decisions and taxing decisions to counteract the normal booms and bust cycles of our economy. As our economy goes through troughs, you know, and valleys and peaks, as our economy is increasing, and then you're going to want to cut back on your spending if it's going up too quickly. You might want to raise taxes. If the economy is sluggish, you want to increase taxes. I'm sorry, increase spending and also reduce taxes. And that's the idea of using fiscal policy to counteract the normal booms and busts of economic cycles. Now, ideally, countercyclical fiscal policy calls for more spending during economic downturns, but less spending during the good times, if you will. All right, and it even suggests building up surpluses during good times. All right, but as you might imagine, it's very difficult politically to build up budget surpluses. It's much easier to create deficits and spend, but it's very, very hard to create budget surpluses. So the first time people start seeing budget surpluses, they're going to be demanding a tax cut because they say, well, the government's taking in too much money. So politically, it's much more feasible to engage in deficit spending, and we've seen a lot of that in the last several years as opposed to budget surpluses. But another thing about countercyclical fiscal policy is that it's hard, not only is it hard to generate surpluses, but it also suggests that why, you know, when you hear people calling for balancing the budget, sometimes that's not, actually not a very good idea, because countercyclical fiscal policy suggests that balancing the budget may be a bad idea, especially when you have economic downturns. And so just to think about this as an example, if you're required to balance the budget and the economy is moving downward, people are losing their jobs. Now, as people lose their jobs, they may need some forms of assistance, like unemployment compensation or food stamps or welfare. And on the other hand, if you are required to balance the budget, you've only got a limited amount of money available for addressing these critical problems. Once that money is gone because you've had to balance the budget, then the problem may remain, but there's just nothing you can do about it. So the argument is that a lot of people who believe in fiscal policy believe that deficit spending can be a good thing, and balancing the budget may not be a good thing because it can actually exacerbate the conditions of the poor during economically depressed times. It can actually exacerbate the magnitude of economic downturn if you're required to balance the budget. So that'd make the argument that you would need to engage in deficit spending to counteract that tendency. And again, as I suggested, it's easier to create deficit spending, but much more difficult to do the other side of the equation, and that is to generate surpluses through increased taxation and reduced spending during times of economic growth. A lot of this also relates to another point about fiscal policy. Relates to the idea of the national debt. And I want to talk for a few minutes about that. What is the national debt, and what is the difference between the national debt and deficit spending? Well, deficit spending, of course, is when in a given fiscal year we're spending more than what we're taking in through taxes. And if we look at the U.S. deficit, it began to radically increase during the 1980s, and then also we saw it from 2000 up to the present time. A lot of scholars looked at this and they said we can make a lot of reasons, come up with a lot of reasons why this would have happened. Ronald Reagan, for example, in 1981 and 1986 had major tax cuts that were designed, part of his supply side economic policies that were designed to stimulate the economy. That was going on in the 1980s. At the same time, we also saw the largest peacetime military weapons buildup that the world has ever seen. So we didn't stop back, cut back spending. And so we had that double amplitude effect on terms of stimulating the economy. But deficits really began to increase during the Reagan administration. We also see, for example, tax cuts by George W. Bush in 2000 and during his tenure, during the Bush administration, and certainly with our war with Iraq, which has led to a lot of government spending. At the same time, more recently, President Obama's economic recovery package, which calls for large amounts of federal spending has to try to stimulate the economy, has also contributed significantly to our deficits and therefore our long-term debt. And so what happens here, as we increase our deficits each year, we increase the national debt. And right now, that national debt is over $11 trillion, if you can imagine. And to pay interest just on the national debt takes a lot of money. It keeps long-term interest rates high, and that can also affect short-term interest rates as well. Now, some people say, well, why is the deficit so high? Does it, you know, well, in part, well, I've given you a little bit of some reasons for that. But also, some people say that because the way we allocate our budget, we don't have something called a capital budget. That is, we pay for large-scale infrastructure projects out of our current operating expenses rather than through some type of long-term financing arrangement. So that actually not having a separate capital budget contributes to our deficit spending in our current operating budgets every year. The fact that we have something called entitlements, which are government payouts, like, for example, Social Security. If you meet a certain threshold or category, Medicare is another example of entitlements. If you meet a certain threshold or category, then you are, quote, entitled to that money. And so entitlements can also contribute to our deficit spending. Now some people, and then as we increase our deficits, we also increase our national debt. So some people wonder, however, is the national debt such a bad thing necessarily? Some people actually suggest that, well, it's not as much, anywhere near as much as what total private sector debt is, and the money that we owe is largely to ourselves, so we shouldn't be too worried about the national debt. But on the other hand, I would make the argument that, you know, if it takes every year as we increase our deficit spending and as our national debt goes up, then every year a greater chunk of our operating budget is taken out and used solely for the purposes of servicing that debt in the form of interest payments. So if you look at our budget as being a pie, a greater chunk of that pie every year is going out simply for interest payments on the national debt. As that national debt increases, then that chunk of money allocated to servicing interest payments on that debt also increase, all right, just to service that debt. And so what that basically means then is that we have less and less discretionary spending, money allocated for other potentially good things that we could be using that money for in our society, in our government, in our policies, instead of going simply to service the interest payments on that debt. So again, that's one of the arguments why the national debt is a growing concern. Now, besides fiscal policy, besides monetary policy, there's also a distinction between economic development policies and economic regulatory policies. Let me talk about some of them briefly. Let's talk about, first of all, economic development policies. These are policies that are designed to help develop and grow our economy. There are basically four general types of economic development policies. The first is the idea of tariff and free trade policies. We can develop our economy by how we deal with tariffs. If we impose tariffs on the importation of foreign goods and products and services, then what happens here is that that can actually, on the one hand, protect American industry and develop American industry, but at the same time, that can also hurt consumers. Because when, for example, clothing, when we impose a tariff or even a quota on the importation of textiles from overseas, we may save American jobs, but again, we're paying more for clothing, the ones that's produced here, but also the ones that's produced overseas as well. So the question is, should we protect the industry or should we let the market take care of itself? Should there be free trade? And a lot of advocates believe that free trade is better overall because the minute we start imposing tariffs, you know, other nations will retaliate, impose tariffs on our goods that we're exporting over there. And so that can actually restrict the flow of trade globally, and that can create overall global depression of our economy. So a lot of people believe that overall free trade is better than having tariffs, but there can be a lot of dislocation in the process. And of course, free trade is not very good if it's not fair trade. In other words, if there's not a level playing field from one country to another. In other words, if one country protects a lot of its industries, but and the other country, like the U.S., does not to the same level, then that may not be considered fair trade. Of course, there's the story of Harley Davidson. For many years, Harley Davidson was in decline, as you know, as in the 70s and the 80s. And at one point in time, Harley Davidson asked the U.S. government to impose tariffs on the importation of motorcycles. For example, Japanese motorcycles like Hondas, the Gold Wings, for example, Suzuki, Kawasaki, and others. And so, with the idea of saying, you know, give us time to retool our manufacturing processes. And so for a temporary period of time, the U.S. government actually engaged in the imposing a tariff on Japanese motorcycles. That gave Harley-Davidson an opportunity to retool, remanufacture, institute new and more efficient manufacturing processes and automated processes in their motorcycles. And that led to more quality in the production process. And then at one point, Harley-Davidson said, Uncle Sam, remove those tariffs. We're ready to compete back again on the world markets. And they really came back quite strongly. So and today, Harley-Davidson is a very, very competitive player in terms of motorcycles. So this is a good example, potentially, of how tariffs can actually work to save an industry that you might want to save and save jobs in the process. Besides tariff versus free trade policies, government can also employ something called tax incentives. Excuse me. This is the idea of giving tax breaks, and it applies to a lot of different areas. for example, cities may give a tax break, so certain industries may come in and create, set up a production plant in that city. And they say, if you come in and set up shop, we're going to give you massive tax breaks. And I think about, for example, BMW. BMW has the only plant outside of Bavaria for BMW cars is located in upstate South Carolina. And one of the reasons why it located there is because the government leaders in that region tried to convince BMW, as it was looking for another place to set up a major production facility, it tried to woo BMW with major tax incentives, tax breaks, and in the process to encourage them. And it was a lot of money that they actually, in terms of what they gave up, in terms of encouraging the company to come in there. But on the other hand, if you look at what's going on in upstate South Carolina, you know, it's turned in, the economy has really benefited quite tremendously by the location and production of BMWs in the United States. So that's the idea about giving tax breaks. Another way you can see tax incentives would be, for example, in terms of how do you stimulate home ownership. One of the major tax incentives that we experience today as homeowners is the ability to, the thing called the mortgage interest deduction. The fact that any interest that we pay on our mortgage, we can deduct every year on our taxes. That's a tax incentive. If you cut back on the mortgage interest deduction, you know, that would actually increase the level of money available to the federal government. But on the other hand, it would significantly decrease the amount of home ownership across our nation, because it would basically make our mortgages less affordable. So that's a tax incentive to stimulate, in this case, home ownership and also the production of new housing. Industrial policies is another example of an economic development policy, and this is the idea that suggests that government might want to get involved, actively involved in promoting a particular industry while abandoning others. So, for example, textiles is a declining industry. It used to be as part of the cotton industry in the South, and textiles associated with that used to be a very vibrant, thriving industry, again, particularly in the South. But over time, that has declined. And if you go ride throughout the South, you'll see fewer and fewer textile plants that are operating. Most of them have closed down. Most of them actually have been converted to apartments and condos and things like that. And the reason why is because as an industry, textiles has become too expensive to pay people to produce textiles here relative to what other countries pay their workers to produce textiles. So it created a really significant competitive imbalance there. So the argument here is that instead of government trying to support and prop up a failing industry like textiles, maybe what the government should do is abandon that. Typewriters would be the same way. Government should abandon trying to save typewriters and typewriter jobs and instead hire people or take people who are losing jobs in these areas and help retrain them, because it might create a lot of dislocation in the process, but retrain them, provide something called trade adjustment assistance, the federal program administered by the Commerce Department. Train them, retrain them to have new skills so that instead they're making typewriters, now they're making computers. Or they're making other kinds of products where the United States has naturally a greater competitive advantage, such as, for example, the aerospace industry. So maybe we should abandon textiles and typewriters and instead strongly support aerospace and the computer industry, as well as other industries such as in the service sector where the U.S. has naturally a much stronger competitive advantage relative to other countries. And then the last type of economic development policy is this notion of supply side policies. And this is the idea of cutting taxes to stimulate investment. This is the idea kind of like in tax incentives where you're giving out tax breaks. It embodies a myriad of ideas or policies, deregulating industries, getting government off the backs of business, okay? Cutting out red tape, cutting out taxes. And the idea here is you're focusing on the idea of putting money back in people's pockets. Because, for example, if I own an industry or a manufacturing facility and I pay less to the federal government, I've got more money in my pocket to spend perhaps on growing my industry. And as I grow my industry, I create jobs. And the idea is that through that process of job creation and growth of industry, a rising tide lifts all boats and we grow the economy that way. So we provide incentives to suppliers, to the producers of capital, and these kinds of incentives is a way to help grow the economy. And that's the idea of supply side economics. It's what people have called before the trickle-down theory of economics, where you provide the suppliers of capital, then through that process, jobs are created in other part, you know, through that process as a byproduct. Now, besides the economic development policies, there are also economic regulatory policies. And when we go back to the discussion of political ideologies, we talked about how the role of government may play an active role in regulating the economy. And we go way back, for example, the first regulatory agency was established at the federal level by the creation of the Interstate Commerce Commission in 1887 to regulate railroads. We have a whole myriad of agencies back then and even today, the Federal Trade Commission, the Food and Drug Administration to make sure, for example, that the products you consume are safe, the Agriculture Department in terms of meat inspections to make sure the meat that you buy at the grocery store is not tainted, the Federal Communications Commission, the Securities and Exchange Commission to regulate the stock market, the Bureau of Industry and Security to regulate the export of high-tech goods overseas, the Consumer Product and Safety Commission to regulate the products that you buy in terms of their safety. And Congress has, of course, also passed various laws throughout our history to prevent the formation of monopolies. A very famous one is the Sherman Antitrust Act of 1890. Today, we see, for example, Congress creating agencies like the Occupational Safety and Health Administration to regulate industries, to regulate the workplace, to regulate workers' health and safety in the workplace. So all these are examples of government getting involved in regulating economic activity, and again, largely for health and safety purposes. That's the benefit of economic regulation. But what is the downside of all that regulation? Well, the downside is that it increases consumer prices, because the more I have to spend, for example, to clean up the atmosphere, if I'm a manufacturing facility, then I have to pass my cost along to consumers who consume my products. So it hurts consumer prices. It hurts international competitiveness, because if my products are cost more, that's going to hurt my ability to compete overseas with other manufacturers who might produce the same things for a lower price. But yet, at the same time, a lot of people recognize the need that some industries need regulation. For example, the savings and loan industry, the bank industry. Some of the bank fallout that we've had during the time when around the year 2008, 2009, when there was a lot of bailout of the banks, was a recognition that the banks needed to have regulation. Too much deregulation allowed them to do too much and engage in risky behavior that created some economic and financial collapses. was a justification for more government regulation. And so the argument here is that the key here is when you're engaging in regulation, you've got to look at the cost and the benefits, because regulatory activity has significant cost, and you've got to think about what are the benefits that are associated with the regulatory activity. If the benefits to society and to people outweigh the cost, then it would be considered to be an appropriate kind of regulation. But if the costs exceed the benefit, then you have to think twice about whether or not you should engage in that kind of behavior. And of course, the problem is trying to calculate benefits and costs in both the short term and the long term can be a very, very difficult and complex process. But in any case, that takes care of some of our discussion on economic policy. Now, I want to shift here and finish our discussion for today talking a little bit about domestic policy, and particularly social welfare policy, the different kinds of programs that we have in place and how they've changed over time. So let's begin, first of all, by talking about historically in social welfare policy about the role of the U.S. government. The U.S. government really did not become actively involved in social welfare policy really until about the Great Depression. Before then, it was pretty much left up to states and local governments and private charities to deal with problems of poverty. There are various kinds of strategies that we have today to deal with poverty, and a lot of these came about through the Great Depression and through dealing with the economic problems that are associated within some of the different agencies that were created back then. But the four different kinds of strategies is a nice way, a framework around looking at the different kinds of strategies to deal with poverty. There's what I would call a punitive strategy, a preventive strategy, an alleviative strategy, and a curative strategy. So let's talk about these different ones. A punitive strategy. A lot of times what you saw in terms of a punitive strategy, again, a lot of these strategies were before the Depression. This is the idea here when, again, you were kind of left up to your own devices to figure out what to do in terms of your, you know, if you were poor, that was too bad. If you owed a lot of money, you would simply go to prison. There's this idea of poorhouse, and people were sent to the poorhouse or debtors' prisons. The idea of state and local general assistance programs that just are designed not to help you any more than they can, or they do not have the money to provide much in the way of assistance. And they have this idea, the reason that these are called punitive strategies, the idea of saying, you know, we're going to punish you because you're poor, because you're not able to pull yourself up on your bootstraps. We're not going to provide you incentives to enjoy this, and we're going to basically kind of keep poverty assistance or welfare assistance at a very, very low level to prevent, provide a significant disincentive for you to remain in poverty. Now, after the Depression during the Depression, the government embarked in a lot of what I would call preventative kinds of strategies to deal with poverty. A lot of this deals with social insurance, Social Security as a form of retirement insurance, survivor's insurance. If your spouse dies, you still have a way of money coming in to help deal with your loss of income. Disability insurance, where you receive money because of loss of income, because of a disability. Unemployment insurance would be another example of a preventative strategy. You lose your job, and at least for a short time, you may receive unemployment insurance, maybe, for example, from state government. Medicare would be a good example of a preventative strategy as well. Medicare is a program to provide health insurance for the elderly, recognizing that the elderly need health care, and recognizing that by paying in to this program, and then Medicare pays out for some health care, this helps provide a little bit of a safety net for the elderly should they have significantly declining health and not having the money to pay for this. Workman's compensation is another example of a program, in this case at the state level, that has a bit of that preventative strategy involved, where you're requiring employers to have insurance to cover persons involved in industrial accidents or work-related health problems. So you've got punitive strategies, you've got preventative, a whole range of preventative strategies. You've also got something called alleviative strategies, and this is typically more along the lines of public assistance than what we normally think about. This involves the idea of supplemental security income, SSI. This is aid for people who are needy, for those who are blind or disabled. Again, this is largely federally financed. Another example had been historically the Aid to Families with Dependent Children, AFDC. This was a major categorical program that was replaced with a block grant program in 1996. And during that year, President Clinton signed into law something called the Personal Responsibility and Work Opportunity Reconciliation Act of 1996. And that converted the AFDC program to something called TANF, a block grant that was jointly financed by the federal government and states. And TANF stands for Temporary Assistance to Needy Families. And it was designed, it built in some incentives that was designed to end the cycle of welfare. There were built-in work requirements. It also gave the states more flexibility in terms of how they administered this program. And it also incorporated certain time limitations so that, for example, recipients could remain on this program for no more than two consecutive years and a lifetime limit of 5 years. The evidence for the TANF has been mixed. Some people, it has certainly reduced welfare rolls, but in some cases, in some areas, it has actually, some evidence has shown that it's actually exacerbated some of the conditions in poverty as well. So the evidence on the research has been mixed on this. But another example of an alleviative kind of strategy would be food stamps. Food stamps are actually federally financed and they're administered through the Department of Agriculture, and again, to help supplement income devoted to food consumption. Medicaid is another example, and this is health care for the poor. Again, because if you can't afford health care, but you need health care, you need health services, the Medicaid program, if you meet the eligibility requirements, then your health care is provided through this program. And then another example of alleviative strategies is something called general relief, state general assistance programs. A lot of variation from one state to the next in terms of how much money and requirements are, but this is again kind of your just general relief program. Public housing is a housing assistance program such as Section 8 vouchers. These are basically ways to help offset your payment of rent if you can't afford an apartment. If it's very expensive and you meet the eligibility criteria, you might be eligible for a Section 8 voucher that's administered through the Department of Housing and Urban Development. And this helps to supplement your income to help you afford the rent for a particular area. Public housing would be another example. Free school breakfast and lunch programs for children who come from low-income families. Special nutrition programs such as the WIC program, Women, Infants, and Children's Program, that provides, for example, free milk products made for your children. Senior citizens nutrition programs, things like that, are all examples of alleviative kinds of strategies. Now, the last kinds of strategies that you would have are known as curative strategies to deal with poverty, curative strategies. And the idea behind curative strategies is more like rehabilitation as opposed to relief, all right? And the idea behind this, I think about job training programs. We had something called the Comprehensive Employment Training Act that lasted for about 10 years from about 1970s throughout the 1970s. It was replaced in the early 1980s by something called the Job Training Partnership Act. But again, it's basically a federal job training program that works with state and local governments as well. Head Start is a very popular program and has shown to be a very, very effective program for children who come from disadvantaged backgrounds, where they're provided a lot of education early on and as part of it and opportunities for learning. And so Head Start is another example maybe of a curative kind of strategy to put children on a good basis for when they actually start school in elementary school or kindergarten. The JTPA is federally financed. It provides subsidies to employers who provide job training to qualified workers. And so those are some examples, again, of curative kinds of strategies. And in terms of talking about poverty, it's interesting to, let me give you some interesting statistics here, some of the latest. The official poverty rate, the information I've got goes back a few years, but say, for example, in 2007 was 12.5%. During that year, 37.3 million people were in poverty. That was up from 36.5 million in 2006. Poverty rates for different groups of people. For whites, this was about 8.2%. Blacks for about 24.5%. Asians, 10.2%. The poverty rate for Hispanics was 21.5%, just to kind of give you a sort of a sense of what the different rates were and the overall rate. The poverty rate for children under 18 years old was 18% in 2007, and for people 65 and over, about 9.7%. Now, if you go back and think about historically, how you know that may seem a little or a lot depending upon your perspective. Obviously, any poverty is more poverty than we need. But think about this, in 1960, the poverty rate was about 22%. Now, the 2007 numbers I gave you of 12.5%, that's obviously has increased and during the economic downturns of 2009 and 2010, and the statistics are still being calculated on that. But again, relatively speaking, much lower than it was in 1960, and 22% in 1960. 11% in 1973, 13% in 1980. And so basically the poverty rate has hovered from about 12 to 14, 15% since 1980. Some of the states with the highest poverty rate include states like Louisiana, Mississippi, West Virginia, Kentucky. Missouri kind of ranks about in the middle of all the states in terms of the poverty rate. Some of the states with the least poverty rate include Hawaii and Connecticut, Alaska and Virginia, Maryland, Colorado, and New Hampshire. Among all adults living in poverty, about 40% had been employed. So it's not people who are completely, a lot of these are actually working poor. Working poor are still living in poverty. Now, in terms of specifically of Missouri, let's talk a little bit about public policy as it pertains to welfare in Missouri. Missouri actually ranks pretty low in spending money on welfare and even education, I should point that out as well. 10 states, for example, spent less than Missouri in elementary and secondary education. Only 4 states spent less than Missouri on higher education. And 7 states spent less than Missouri on welfare. So 42 states spent more than Missouri on welfare. The Missouri Constitution, this is somewhat tied to the Missouri Constitution because the Constitution requires the General Assembly, that is our legislature, to pay for certain services before others. So for example, principal and interest payments on the Missouri public debt must be paid first. And that has to be paid before Missouri can fund public education. And both of these come before supporting other kinds of programs like public health and welfare. Now, at the same time, Missouri actually has engaged in some important kinds of programs, and I think one of them is particularly innovative. And that is the Parents as Teachers program. The Parents as Teachers program is a program that has been adopted by several states. And this is basically where child experts in child development, you can sign up for free. It's a free program. If you're a new parent, you can sign up for this program even at the hospital when your child is born. And they will put you on a list. And parents, child development experts will come to your house. And these individuals are specifically trained to examine your child, play with your child, examine the child in terms of have they achieved a certain age, certain developmental milestones. They provide different kinds of ways to help parents encourage their cognitive and social development. So it's the idea of helping to help their parents become better teachers at raising their children. Other states have actually looked at this and seen this as a real benefit and have adopted a program very similar to Parents as Teachers. But in a lot of ways, I look at Missouri as one of the innovators in this regard. There's also something called the Futures Program here in Missouri. It's a case management program generally targeted to younger welfare recipients. It's designed to help move that person off of welfare. This program basically involves child care with job training, and it provides a supplement to you if you have minimum wage job. So again, we see some examples of Missouri programs that are designed to deal with people who are in poverty, as well as again just parents and early intervention of children in terms of their social and cognitive development. But in any case, this is probably a good point to stop. We're going to continue our discussion on policy and policy process when we talk next time. And there we're going to be covering a lot of different aspects of defense policy and various challenges to our national security over time. So, until then, this is Patrick Scott. We'll see you next time.